particles of wave-like properties.
This statement, one of the main ideas in tiny physics, can also explain why the sun, huge as it is, can make all kinds of elements, all kinds of energy that we rely on.
We were taught that from the basic hydrogen atom, because the sun is huge, there's a lot of gravity pushing these atoms together, merging them and making heavier elements. Gravity alone isn't actually strong enough to merge atoms together, but nature has something else that allows gravity to do that.
You guessed it, it's quantum tunneling. We'll start by setting up a graph.
If you want the hydrogen atom to fuse together with another, you're basically putting them near enough that they look like a single bigger atom, right? But first, you'd need to overcome this barrier of energy, which is the repulsion produced by light charges between the hydrogen nuclei.
When I say energy barriers, they don't necessarily have to mean a wall. Instead, they're anything that requires a specific amount of energy for you to be able to pass through them.
As for this region, nothing's stopping the atom from moving around here, so we can think of the energy needed to be here as zero. Also notice that once we pass through the barrier, the energy needed to be there is also minimal. But why? This is because once we get past the barrier, the strong force takes over. What is that? This is what glues multiple protons and neutrons in a nucleus, but it only works at extremely small distances. So you basically have to go through this wall of repulsion before you can reach the stable strong force area. We also set the energy this atom has as some value E, which is less than the energy needed to be here, U. The value doesn't matter, so long as the energy is less than what's required to actually pass through, then we shouldn't find the atom here, right? When it does, it's quantum tunneling.
This next part's gonna get real equation-y, so warm up if you have to. Now I said particles have wave-like properties. What does that mean?
See, the smaller we go, the wave properties of objects become more noticeable. In a given period, we get to observe consistent values for amplitudes and frequency. So consistent that we can represent the system we're observing with a simple sine function. W equals A sine kx. We'll be taking how fast this wave changes when the position changes, symbolized by this, W prime. And we also take how fast that change happens to get another equation, W double prime equals negative k squared a sine kx, which is just negative k squared W.
If these don't make sense to you, watch a video on basic differentiation and then please come back.
At this point, I'll be including a relation we often use in physics. The total energy of the system, which is just the sum of the potential energy and kinetic energy. We carry out some operations, such as defining kinetic energy as 1/2 mv squared, defining mv as p, defining p as h bar k, using our first equation, and finally replacing all of this with a single constant b so it's easier to look at. This kind of equation doesn't look like something you can directly get an answer with, and it's called a differential equation. That's a whole other world you have to get into if you don't know what a differential equation is. But what's important now is that this one has a form where the solutions are easily known. Depending on whether this constant is positive or negative, we get different answers. In this region, the atom's energy, E, is greater than the energy needed to be around this area, U. E minus U is positive, and for a negative constant, we get a solution in the form of sine and cosine functions. In this region, U is not at all zero, in fact, it's greater than E. E minus U is negative, we end up with a positive constant, and the solution turns out to be made of exponential functions. I trust that you got all that, if not, go back, it's always better the second time around. Now, the solutions we got are what we use to get something more concrete, the probability functions. These are just functions that tell us how likely we are to find the particle in specific positions. Our computations predict that there is in fact a possibility for an atom to pass through a higher energy barrier. Although, if we were to get deeper, we find that the exponential decay portion has a larger coefficient than the term containing exponential growth. With that, the likelihood that tunneling happens decreases the thicker the barrier. So the chances that the atom would even end up here is already so small. But when you have a system that is huge, such as one making up a bunch of particles like the sun, that small probability compounds and creates such an intense effect.
Now I want to point something out. As we add more and more particles to form our normal scale objects, we're actually adding the waves of each particle.
And the overall wave doesn't look so much a wave than it does some spike. With that, the likelihood that this particle is in this region lessens at a huge rate because the spike happens to be further away from the barrier. That's why we don't observe objects that aren't energetic enough to be passing through energy barriers at the big scale.
So there's a lot of stuff I explained, from what an energy barrier means in the context of the sun, using the total energy of the system to show you how quantum tunneling is possible, but really the main thing I want you to take from all of this is how amazing ideas in the quantum scale are, and that they can explain how the sun does its sun things.
Particles have wave-like properties. That's it. As usual, do subscribe if you want more science and what I think are cool animations. While you're here, do check out my gravity and dark matter videos. Thanks for watching, I'll see you next time.